AGM at Christchurch, and you were one of the first people I met, along with James Shaw, I remember very clearly. Now, for those who are on social media, John is also known by the nickname of Farm Geek. So if you're a social media follower and you don't follow Farm Geek, please look him up because he's very entertaining. And he's also got a background in IT and runs a rural technology trust for young people out of the Wairarapa. So he's got multiple strings to his bow, and I'm very pleased that we've got him here tonight. Thank you so much for coming and travelling, John. It's great to have you.
Alright, so you can hear me okay towards the middle and the back, everything? This is a great spot. The acoustics are fantastic. So, thank you so much for coming. It's a bit of a miserable night out there. So, thanks to Jan and Nicola and the whole branch for hosting me tonight. We've had a wonderful AGM and some lovely food, which you haven't seen, but trust me, it was lovely. As Nicola said, my name's John Hart. I'm an organic sheep and beef farmer from the Wairarapa. I'm also the Green Party candidate for Wairarapa as well. So tonight, briefly, I'd like to talk to you about something that I quite like, I love, and that's farming. Now, I don't profess to have all the answers tonight. What I'd like to do is talk to you about some of my thoughts about where I think farming is going, where it could go, and some of the ways that we can get to a more sustainable future. So to start with, I'd like to try a quick thought experiment. Think back to the last thing you ate today. Might have been a few minutes ago, it might have been lunchtime. Who made that for you? Who grew the ingredients for that piece of food? Where were those ingredients grown? Somewhere in the world, farmers are growing every single meal that we eat. And I think in the debate about farming, we sometimes forget that we all have a stake in a sustainable future for farming, because it literally feeds all of us every single day. So when I was a kid in the 1970s, almost everyone that I knew had a connection with farming somewhere. We had aunties, uncles, grandparents with farms. We'd go to farms on holidays if you didn't already live on a farm. That seems to have changed in the last 30 odd years. We're more city-based than ever. I think Stats New Zealand qualifies it as 86% of us live in places classed as urban. So the vast majority of us live in cities now. More and more we're losing our connection with what it means to be growing food and living on the land. And I think we're much poorer for it. So why is that important? Why should we care about that loss of connection with that, where our foods come from? As we address the issues facing farming today and into the future, we've got to do more to grow empathy on both sides of the urban-rural divide. Now, while it's a symptom of our disconnection from where our foods come from, it's also a huge barrier. The problems we face as a country and as a globe need solutions. And to implement those solutions and have a hope of them working, we've got to have much, much better ways of working together across urban and rural sectors. So tonight I'd like to start by talking about farming from my point of view and why I think that infinite growth is impossible. Now, that seems like a pretty simple thing to say, but we act as if it's not. In many ways, New Zealand farmers are victims of their own success. We've doubled dairy production since 2008. But we haven't doubled dairy profit in that intervening years as well. So in 1994, there were 3.5 million cows in New Zealand. Less than 25 years later, it's 6.5 million cows. Now they're producing more milk than ever too, per cow. If we continue that growth path, by 2040 we would have 12 million cows in New Zealand. Now each cow produces roughly 14 to 15 times the effluent of a human being. So our current national herd is equivalent to 90 million freedom campers. Doing their business. That's a lot of people. Now even Nathan Guy, our Minister of Prime Industries, has this last week admitted that we cannot continue to intensify dairy forever. Now, it's great news to hear. It would have been good to have maybe had that conversation 20 years ago, but it's a start. The National Government's business growth agenda is to double agricultural exports by 2025. Now, primarily, their means to do that is through growing the dairy industry. But at the same time, we're starting to bump up against physical limits of production. Parts of the country are already seeing farming densities that are not compatible with long-term health of people, waterways, and communities. So what do we do? Conservation groups, NGOs, and even some political parties are getting a little bit more urgent in their messaging about this situation. Well, there's election year after all, so that's going to happen. We cannot keep forever growing an industry that has tangible negative externalities on the environment around it. Now, for me, the fundamental tension that I see is, do we farm to limits, and do we accept there are biological limits to what we're doing, or do we deny those limits and forge ahead? Now, there are a huge number of farmers that are doing a lot to reduce their impact on both the land and the water, and mitigate what they can't avoid. And it's fair to say they should get a lot more publicity and credit for that. But here's the fundamental problem. Individual farmers' efforts are being swamped by the impact of an ever-growing industry. So if you put it simply, the collective damage done is happening faster than individual farmers can make small changes to reduce their impact. So this government has committed $400 million in an irrigation investment fund to give life to irrigation schemes that possibly wouldn't make it off the drawing board without that support. This is in the face of admitting that we can't keep intensifying agriculture, especially dairy, forever. Agriculture is our second largest export earner after tourism. I think it's just this last week it's just been tipped out by tourism. Now, to put that into context, rural communities rely on farmers. They rely on farmers spending money on contractors. They rely on farmers spending money on services. Huge amounts of rural New Zealand rely on farmers being profitable. We can't escape that fact. We have to look at the other side of the ledger as well. Farming accounts for half of our greenhouse gas emissions as a country. Now, if we're serious about meeting our Paris commitments as a country, we can't ignore where half of our emissions are coming from. The latest stats from the Ministry for the Environment show that 72% of our monitored rivers are unsafe for swimming at some times of the year. 70% of our native fish species are at risk of extinction. The latest MOE report shows that nitrogen pollution is increasing in more than half of all monitored rivers across the country. And if you reduce that down to just the lowland rivers, it's probably more like 75%. So if you care to look, the evidence is pretty clear that agriculture is having an impact on the environment around us. Now, on top of that, farming is facing some threats. Farming as usual is facing some significant threats in our near future. Now, climate change is the big one for me. We know that we're going to get more rainfall in some areas and less rainfall in other areas. That rainfall is going to be delivered in much larger chunks. We're going to see more floods, more storms. We all remember the 2013 big storm in North Canterbury that wiped out 800 irrigators in one go. That was a pretty unusual event, but I can't imagine that happens too many more times before the insurance company starts saying, we're not going to fund the infrastructure you rely on. Of course, we've had Selwyn flooding twice in a reasonably short time, once in 100-year floods. Something we've noticed in Wairarapa, pests and parasites this year have been a real problem. And I don't know if it's the same up here. How many farmers have we got in the room? So you're spending more on drench at RD1 than you normally would? Because we found down in Wairarapa it's been a terrible, terrible autumn for parasites. Warm and moist after a pretty mild winter, we've been getting hammered by it. But these are the sort of things we're going to face under climate change going forward. Threat number two, synthetic protein. Now, at the moment it's easy to scoff at synthetic protein. What I'm talking about is right now in labs and factories around the world, technicians are making meat and milk from sources that are not animal. Now, you can say it's not real meat, it's not real milk. When it's cheaper and more consistent than the real thing, it's going to take off. Now, you've got to go look at the history of the wool carpet in New Zealand to see an example of that. Post-World War II, when synthetic fibres came along, nobody believed they would displace wool. Why would you not want to buy the real thing, the better product? Fast forward 20, 30 years and you were hard-pressed to find wool carpet. Nylon just took over. So synthetic protein is already being produced in a lab at a price comparable to cow-grown milk. Now, it's only a matter of time before that is cheaper and more consistent than anything we can produce in the paddocks. Now, there are a huge number of people in the world that will always want to buy the real thing, and I'm one of them. I would never drink synthetic milk myself. But think about this. The vast majority of what we produce gets sent overseas as ingredients for other people's food. Now, if you're a manufacturer of products, you want cheap, consistent ingredients. Now, if we can deliver synthetic milk that is functionally the same as cow dairy, they're going to buy it. And unless you look at every ingredient on the back of your packet of processed food now, you're going to eat it unless you know it otherwise. What I think the upshot of that is going to be is that the commodity prices that we rely and live and die on right now are going to start creeping ever closer to lower and lower prices. There'll be a new floor set on the commodity price of milk powder in the near future. I mean, within our lifetime. What do we do as a nation when we rely on exporting milk powder when that price is being eroded every year underneath us? That I see that as an enormous threat to our industry. The third threat I can see, and it's probably more immediate, is the social license to farm. Now, we've always taken for granted the right to farm, to do what we want with our land. Now, against a backdrop of an industry and a government that wants to grow its way to prosperity, there's a tangible shift happening in the public mood, and we see it all the time now in the way the media portray farming, in the way the public perceive farming, and to be fair, the way that people... So Lincoln University has just released its 8th Public Perceptions of New Zealand's Environment Survey. Now, they found that twice as many people now blame farming for damaging fresh water as in 2000. It's a huge increase in just a few years. Now, if we ignore that shift in mood, we risk a larger political reality that while they may not live in rural areas, urban voters care about what happens on our farms. Urban voters want to see solutions, and if they don't see solutions from the industry, then the politicians will get their turn. And that's an outcome that most of us don't actually want. So a lot of the recent response I've seen from industry around responses to these stories in the media and the public perception is, we've got to get better at telling our stories. We've got to put our stories out there. And I agree, to an extent, there are a lot of farmers that should be celebrated for what they're doing. But I think it misses the wider point that rather than presenting a united front of communication, the industry as a whole needs to be better at living up to the stories that we tell about what we're doing. So in marketing, perception is reality. But we need to shift our reality of farming closer to the image of farming that we sell people. And it comes back to that urban-rural divide. 30 years ago, everyone knew how farms worked. They had relatives on farms, they visited farms. In the intervening time, we've kept telling the story of lush green hills and happy cows and everything's wonderful. In the meantime, the public gets glimpses of the way we treat bobby calves. They get glimpses of what happens with palm kernel. They get glimpses of effluent management when it's in the news for all the wrong reasons. So you can understand why the public starts to get a bit disillusioned with farming when the perception and the reality are kind of jarring and different when they see it under the lid. And that's an issue for us. So where do we go to from here? I think context is really important. We know that hundreds of thousands of New Zealanders are employed by the agriculture industries. We have to acknowledge that up front. So for most people that I know in the rural sector, this is not an abstract discussion. This is not something you can discuss over a coffee in Auckland. It's real life for these people. So we have to be really careful when we talk about policies and impacts of policies as a political organisation. So I've talked to a lot of farmers who feel they would like to do things differently, but they feel possibly trapped by the circumstances. Now, I look at this as a game of musical chairs. We've had government policies, we've had market conditions for 150 years that have got us to where we are now. And you cannot blame farmers for responding to those commercial and regulatory things they find themselves soaking in. But you also can't turn off the music and say, sorry, we're stopping now, and put 150 years of restitution on one generation of farming. That's manifestly unjust as well. So how do we get from there to where we want to be as a sustainable nation? So farmers I've talked to have said, well, we've always done it this way, it's hard to change, which is fair enough. I was at a conference 2 weeks ago and a young farmer stood up and she said, this is all great, you've got this wonderful vision of sustainable agriculture and high value add. How do I get there when my fruit reps are telling me what chemicals to put on my farm? When my farm advisors are telling me what chemicals to put on my farm? When my bank tells me I cannot change the way that I farm, how do I get from here to there? And that's the question for all of us. So I'd like to finish up with some positive solutions, because it's been a little bit doom and gloom so far. So there are examples of farmers that are actually doing amazing stuff. One of those is right here, Blue Duck Station, not that far from here. For me, they're an amazing example of what ecotourism can be. You've got a working farm that's producing meat and fibre. You're also putting thousands of tourists a year through the farm. Now, they're going back to their home countries, crazy advocates for New Zealand farming, because what they see, they love. And that's the story that we've got to tell to the rest of the world. We've got one local to us in Hawke's Bay called Mangarara Station, the family farm. They're 600 hectares of sheep and beef, but they're also doing regenerative planting, wetland protection, and ecotourism. So from a Green Party point of view, my perspective is we need to start putting some externalities back into play to allow farmers to make the right decisions to move where they want to go. And by that I mean externalities are a cost on a business that aren't borne fairly or fully accounted for in that business. So when you avoid externalities, you're actually distorting the market. You're not allowing businesses to make the right decisions. So in 2014, the Green Party released a good half a dozen policies that addressed some of those externalities and allowed us to talk about how we could shift things to a more sustainable footing. We talked about putting a price on carbon so that those that were producing greenhouse gases would be disincentivized, and those on the other side of the coin, which often wasn't reported, who sequestered carbon would be rewarded. So that was things like allowing riparian planting to be included in carbon credits, encouraging farm forestry for carbon credits. More than that, fixing the emissions trading scheme so that carbon actually had a proper price, so it was worth planting trees. We talked about putting a resource rental price on water to drive more efficiency, and personally I would even go so far as to look at tradable rights so that you could actually use the water for the best use, the most profitable use, within a context of the regulatory framework. We had a policy for $1 billion extra of science, research and development funding. A large part of that would have helped towards low carbon farming and new technologies. So our policies for this election are still coming. Obviously, they're going to be released over the next few months, but I suspect there'll be many along similar lines. So to wind up, I think we really can have thriving rural economies that centre around activities that enhance the environment rather than degrade it. A lot of our farmers are already leading the way, but we need industry and government to support them and to help spread that information wider. We need to make the transition to a sustainable rural economy in a fair and just way. And I believe that the Green Party is the only political party that actually honestly believes in sustainable farming and wants to help get us there. Now, we're not going to win everybody over. I'm looking around the room and I know we're not going to win everybody over. But we have to try. We have to engage. And as I said earlier, if these solutions have any chance of working, we've got to bring people with us on the journey. So I'm here to say, I want to talk.
I've left a lot of time for questions because I do want to talk to you about what's important to you. And I'd like to finish by saying thank you for your time.
Thanks so much, John. That's awesome. So we don't have a roving mic, so do your best to speak up. And if they've got a quiet voice, John, you and me will summarise what the question is.
We'll shout.
Yeah, we'll summarise it back for you so that you can hear. Who wants to kick off? Have you got one, Angus? Your dad has.
So, really, talking through everything you said to us, your solution to farming is bringing in more tourists.
I'll start by saying I don't profess to have all the answers. That was one example. That was just one example of farming that was integrating tourism and working farming. So it was extra income.
I thought you were going to swap the cows for freedom campers.
Yeah, I'm not sure more freedom campers is going to be the long-term solution either.
What's your definition of sustainable farming?
That's a really good question. For me, it's fundamentally it's farming that doesn't take away options from future farmers. So whether that's keeping the water clean so that future farmers have land use options, or it's keeping the social contract so future farmers can farm, or it's creating a regulatory environment that allows farming to carry on in the future, and that for me is the fundamental core of sustainable farming. You can get down to technical details about practice if you want, but that's for me the overarching view.
Yeah, Andy Jardine, I'm a local deer farmer and businessman, and congratulations, I think I agree with most of your address tonight.
Thank you.
But I do get a bit upset when Greens in particular and others keep attacking dairy farmers as a soft target. I've got lots of friends who are dairy farmers, and in this area you cannot supply your milk to open country or Fonterra unless you've been audited and have all your waterways fenced off and planted in riparian planting. And we don't have the same problem with the Whanganui River, or for that matter the Waitotra or Rangitiki rivers, of significant phosphate and nitrogen runoff into the rivers like you do in some other areas. And I agree with you actually, the intensification of places like the Canterbury Plains has gone too far. You know, when you talk about dairy farmers mistreating their bobby calves, there's always 1% bad apples. Outlaws and other animals, and they treat their animals well, and they're great farmers. And I don't believe you make yourself any friends by continually attacking your dairy farmers with some of the stuff that you see in the media. They're all good people, they all work hard, they're struggling to make a dollar, and we need to support them. And I do get upset when I hear some of the policies. I'm not sure if this is green policy, but I read something in the paper the other day about some aspects of the left wanting to get rid of 33% of the country's total livestock to address their greenhouse emissions. You get rid of 33% of the livestock in this area, Hara, Whanganui, we're rural servicing towns, you will destroy our economies. You'll see Inlay Freezing Works closed down. You'll see open dairy country transferring somewhere else. We can't allow these policies to destroy our rural agricultural base for rural servicing towns simply to meet some nice to have green targets.
No, and I honestly couldn't agree more. I think there has to be a just trend. If there's going to be a transition, it has to be just. You can't just cut people off the knees. And you've got to understand the wider context of the rural economies. They rely on what farmers do. Christian?
The concept of doing it fairly and justly, in a way, to me, is sort of not really the core issue. The reality of the facts on the ground are that change has to happen, and it actually has to happen now. It can't happen over several generations. It actually has to happen now. Because if it doesn't happen now, what will happen in the future will be a lot worse. Farmers who are doing good stuff, but as you say, they're a minority, they're not a majority, And that puts it.
I think you can draw a distinction.
I think, can I just ask that we don't criticise other people's comments, because it's going to get a bit messy if we go one way and then the other. Try and hold those criticisms in sight.
Okay, so, all right, so I'll say that there are still a lot of farmers who are not doing what they should be doing, because we know that by what is happening to the waterways. And some people's reaction to what is happening, because they see that change needs to happen now, and it's not happening as fast as is required, that they're just giving up certain things, like they're giving up beef.
Mm-hmm.
They're not going to be eating that for the rest of their lives, okay? They're giving up things like milk, they're not, or industrial milk. You know, they're just stepping away from those things. They're changing the way that they eat and feed themselves and still being healthy, but they're not supporting something that they know. And there's thousands and thousands and thousands of people doing it in New Zealand, because they see that not enough is happening fast enough. They're not criticising the people who are doing it right, but, you know, the reality is that the change has to happen in this generation. It can't be spread across several generations. It has to happen now.
Yeah, I want to pick up on that, because I think you've made some interesting points. And just transition doesn't mean slow transition necessarily. There are radical changes coming. I mean, synthetic protein is not anyone's policy. It's happening. It's going to happen to us. You know, that's going to be like a slow version of foot and mouth. It's going to be devastating if we don't prepare for it. But it's not going to be a slow change. And I think part of the problem, we've had groups like Fed Farmers and Greenpeace and the Green Party and, you know, Beef and Lamb or Dairy NZ doing this for 20, 30 years. And we shout at each other, and does anything change? No, we just keep doing that. And the problems have gotten worse and worse. We're too busy beating each other over the head. The only way we can solve these problems is to actually work together. And I'd love to take the argument away from individual farmers, because I've already said, I think the problem is bigger than individual farmers. You can have a farmer doing everything right, 100% textbook under today's rules that were different from yesterday's rules and different from day four's rules. They can be completely right and still be having an impact on the land. The whole industry is growing faster than individual farmers can shrink their impact. So we have an industry-wide industry impact problem that's bigger than individual farmers. And I think we won't move forward if we fixate on attacking individuals. That's the problem.
Yeah, but I'd just like to clarify a point made over there about possible Green Party policy to reduce the national herd by a third.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, these ideas have been raised by independent economists, not Green Party people, who have not Green Party policy to my almost certain knowledge. And so,
and they were talking about the science of measuring carbon in the soil, and there's an enormous potential for us to store tens and tens of millions of tons of carbon a year just by growing topsoil.
Mm.
And if we can find a way to account for that, farming could be carbon neutral tomorrow if we could figure out a way to do that. So.
Yeah, well, just following on from the gentleman that I spoke before, I've always struggled to understand why you keep talking about livestock as our single biggest polluters when your farm is growing grass and crops and shelter belts and riparian plantings, etc. That's all sequestering carbon.
Mm.
And indeed, I saw a figure, which I presume is correct, that collectively our New Zealand pastoral farming sequesters more carbon than all the exotic forests in New Zealand put together, simply because there's 20 times more acreage in pasture than there is in exotic forests. So why aren't, and when you're talking about the methane and the carbon dioxide that the cows emit, which we all agree is a pollutant towards greenhouse gas warming and climate change, etc., why aren't you taking the other side of the equation into account, which is all the carbon that is sequestered on farms through the pasture, the crops, the plantations, the small woodlots, etc., that all farmers have on their farms? And indeed, if you look at the other side of the equation, I know there's some foresters here, but where's the fairness and equity when foresters get given a significant, or used to be, not anymore, but they still get carbon credits for planting forests, which sequesters carbon during the 25 years they grow. But when that tree is harvested, 2/3 of the tree rots and emits all that carbon back in the form of methane, just like the cows do. And indeed, another good portion gets lost in bark and sawdust. So in fact, it's only about 25% of that tree ends up as timber used in building or in timber products. The other 75% comes back as methane when the sawdust, the bark, the trimmings, the pine needles all rots back into the atmosphere. So I struggle to understand how you guys keep wanting to penalise the poor farmer and you keep saying that they are our single biggest polluter, when in fact the farms sequest a lot of carbon on the other side of the equation.
I think you raised some good points. I think the challenge with pasture-based carbon is it's such a short cycle that it's very, very hard to measure. But there could be some issues. I haven't seen the figures around carbon in trees that you talked about, but it's worth talking about.
I've got John.
I was going to ask about synthetic protein. It's all very well making it from something else, but how much energy goes into converting from possibly soybeans and transporting it, etc.? Is that perhaps going to have a bigger carbon footprint than milk?
It's a good question. The numbers that I've seen so far are that synthetic milk is being produced with about 90% less water use and about 75% less energy use than putting crops through cows and milking them that way. So there may be increased energy costs in other parts of the process, but the initial look is that it's a big win in terms of energy and resource use.
We mentioned earlier on a social license to farm. What do you mean about that? I mean, the thing that's bothering me, maybe tied into that comment, how do we get younger farmers onto the land and having them trained so that they can start off doing it under the new concepts of information we've got from now? And I'm sure a lot of them would like to, but as you said, they're caught with great loans, and then the banks demand certain things, and they probably have to have the farm advisor, and they're not pushing all the fertilizers. So that, with the best will in the world, a lot of them, I think, are a bit hamstrung. Versus the corporate farm, because I see a smaller family-owned farm probably still maintaining better concepts of farming with the rotation of crops, growing their own food stock, not imported. It's when you get into the agribusiness, farming and lands and areas where there should never have been probably dairy anyhow, then you have to then bring in palm kernels, falling around rainforest and to grow kernels, and to me another worry is perhaps introducing tropical diseases coming in with these kernels that could affect our farming. But I still think is there any plan or something that could be done to help young ones, if they don't inherit a farm, God knows how any of the young ones can even get into it. And I certainly agree we need farming. It's a mainstay of our country, and I've got farming brothers and things, but it's a very different ball game now. Is there any, is that like a license to farm? Do you actually mean that? Or
when I say social license to farm, I'm not talking about you get licensed by the government or someone or not. I'm talking about the willingness of the public to let us do what we do. And that's the risk I see, is if the public, the wider public who vote, don't see that the industry's doing enough.
Well, if we could get more young people in with a different concept rather than a collective bunch of businessmen who think, well, let's buy up a hunk of land here and we'll just have 1,000 cows, each cow numbered once, 6,000, and then pretend that they've all got names and we love them individually and dearly.
Absolutely agree with you there. I think that the best way to make generational change is to get a new generation of farmers coming through. But that's a challenge. I deal with rural technology in the Wairarapa, and we teach farming students and college students how to use new tools like drones and GPS-driven tractors. And a lot of kids just see farming as a, well, little Johnny's not very good at English, so go and do ag. And it's the default for too many kids. It needs to be the choice for more kids, and that's the challenge that we've got. Personally, I would love to see a proper government-funded extension service like we used to have that isn't beholden to chemical companies or fertiliser reps or, you know, ag companies. It truly independent best practice advice that's, you know, useful for each region. And that's something I'd love to see.
I just want to check in. I've certainly got at least two, maybe three questions, four questions. And then I want to offer people to stay for a cup of tea and be able to talk in smaller groups or one-on-one with John. But I just want to check whether there's people holding back who still have a question. They're bursting out. Yeah, good. Okay, I'm at 5, 6, 7. Great. Okay, so we're going to keep going a bit longer. I just want to check in that everyone's still okay to keep going. I mean, it's clearly really interesting stuff. Cool. Okay, we're going to go for another 7 or so questions. At the back. Did you? Yeah. Next, Henry. Did you still want to speak?
No.
You're all right.
I've got other things saved.
Okay, cool.
First.
Stella.
The fencing of streams has been mentioned a couple of times, and these rules particularly apply to dairy farmers, and yeah, the compliance with these rules is great. I just wanted to say that a lot of people don't realise that this is only applied to streams that are wider than a metre and deeper than 30 centimetres. So all of those smaller streams are not covered by these requirements. They can be, you know, the cows can be trampling through them as much as they like until they get to that size, then they are fenced, but they're already thoroughly polluted. I'm a fish specialist, I work with native fish, and for fish, the vast majority of them actually prefer those streams that are smaller than that size. But the bigger waterways are just used as highways to get to them from the sea. So it's, yes, the compliance to that rule is really good at the moment, but it's ignoring the smaller streams, which are really, really important for both habitat and water quality.
Thanks. And a question to follow up for the dairy farmers, does that compliance apply to dairy support or just the platform itself? But now the figures we talk about are working farm, working platforms, right? Not the dairy support as well.
Dairy support, I think, by 2022 right. Or something.
Okay, yeah. Because obviously cows have to go somewhere in the winter.
You define dairy support, you mean run, what might be...
Yeah, run off or the places that aren't being used for milking.
So I'm not a farmer, but I'm good with numbers. And you said that we had in the last 10 years, that we doubled the numbers of cows. So my question is, how much profit do we need to make in order to maintain a good business? And how many more cows can we afford? Or can we afford more cows at all? I mean, we've got only a certain portion of land, and how many cows can we put on this land? That's my question. If I see the Canterbury Plains, all green, and where the irrigation system can't get to, it's like a desert. So I don't know if that's sustainable or not.
Yeah.
And how many cows should be per square meter on those Canterbury Plains?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. That's a big question I'm interested in.
And it's a complex question. There is no simple answer for the whole country because, you know, soil type, weather conditions, what you've got growing there, how close you are to rivers, those are all factors that depend. Determine what sensible levels of stocking are. I think most of us probably agree that there are areas of the country already that have too many cows in them, or too much density of cows. The challenge is, how do you equitably step back from that? It's interesting, Dairy NZ did some research a couple of years ago looking at the last 10 years of dairy expansion, and what they found was that the majority of herds that have grown larger were no more profitable for the extra production. Now, you've got this concept of sort of productive sweet spot where your income is going up because you add more cows and you produce more milk, but your costs are going up at a different rate. And eventually you start to, your sort of marginal return for every extra bit of production gets less and less. So the finding from Dairy NZ was that a lot of farms could probably come back maybe 10%, 15% on stocking rates and be just as profitable. So, you know, we're logical.
logical creatures. We make economic decisions based on spreadsheets and logic. So why don't you just do that? That's my question.
So can I answer that? And profit. But a lot of the profit in any farming is actually the capital gain in the ownership of the land. So the larger the operation, the larger the capital gain potential. So the balance sheet does not always, it shows a profit and loss account, but it does not show you an asset base.
Right. And is that related to the fact that so much of the land value is based on production?
Some of it.
So if you can prove you produce more, your capital value goes up.
In some cases.
Which is also scarcity.
Sorry?
They're not making any more land, so it's a scarce resource.
Oh, sure.
So, given that climate change is soon, well, fast becoming an existential problem for humanity, so we burn more and more fossil fuels, global population is rising, animal farming is a major contributor to carbon emissions, and also, so given that the population is rising, it's unlikely to have a vast reduction. It will globally have to be a massive reduction. Animal farming seems to be less efficient than feeding the world in agriculture, vegetable farming. So whether we like it or not, globally, there will have to be this move to meat becoming dairy, a smaller proportion in one's diet, or if people are genuinely concerned about the environment, they completely move away from animal products. So what is your thought on this need, and the Green Party, does it advocate?
The Green Party doesn't have a particular policy on what people should eat.
No.
We don't want to go quite that far.
We know we must reduce carbon emissions, and animal agriculture is a big part of the problem. So if people are serious about climate change, this is one of the single biggest things people can do. So,
don't worry,
we're
all
going to
eat ourselves. Naturally.
So here's the thing. In New Zealand, we're a bit of an anomaly in the world because we're a first world country that has an emissions profile of a more agrarian third world country. The rest of the world, agriculture is one of the contributors to greenhouse gases, but fossil fuel burning is still the single biggest one. So if we attacked fossil fuels with the same vigor that we talk about reducing animal farming, we would go a long way towards solving the problem pretty quickly. I think a lot of these things will take care of themselves. So if individual countries put in place, say, a carbon tax or emission trading scheme in order to achieve their Paris goals, then agriculture will have to respond across the board. So, you know, there are mechanisms in place, and agriculture shouldn't be different from any other form of greenhouse gas production. We have a regulatory environment, we hope it will respond, and we try and achieve our targets. So I don't think you can go too far down the track of making people eat or not eat certain things. I don't think that's going to work, given how much trouble we have with other methods of compliance and other responses to regulation. Is that kind of...
I've heard if you count all the externalities, like maybe it doesn't hold true for New Zealand because it's perhaps an anomaly, but in the States, for example, okay, rainforests, not in the States, but globally, if rainforests are being deforested for, let's say, animal agriculture, then that's incorporated. If the stuff is being trafficked around, that carbon cost is incorporated. Now, I'm not sure if this is true, but I've heard it's up to 45% of global carbon emissions are because of agriculture, because of all those other things. It's not just
those other things. I'm not trying to minimise your argument.
Transporting around, I mean, when we have an insane economy where stuff is perhaps transported too far.
Well, we export enormous amounts of meat, and we import enormous amounts of meat into New Zealand. So, you know, from a carbon point of view, that just makes no sense at all. But it's arbitrage. You know, we export meat to Japan for $25 a kilo. We get it from Australia and Argentina for $3 a kilo and put it in the supermarket. So, at one level, it makes perfect sense. At another level, it's insane. So, yeah. Like I said, humans are rational creatures. We're really good at that stuff.
No, I want to get close to wrapping up, and I've got 1, 2, 3, 4. And that might be it. Okay, go, Tim.
Thank you. Just to bring this back to a bit more of a local context, what happens in the rest of the world, why it's important what we'd really like to hear from the Green Party is what's happening locally. The Wanganui District Council area, 77% of that is Class 6 and 7 hill country. So you're not going to be doing much cropping on that. There's about 5% of the Wanganui District Council area that is suitable for cropping. What is the Greens' approach to how we deal with our hills, whether we farm it, whether we retire it and put it into forest? What do we do with it? Where is the economy for Wanganui going to go if three quarters of it is based on hill country?
That's a really good question, and I think at a local granular level, I'd be really suspicious of anyone that told you they knew what they should do with your land. I think we should be talking about setting the regulatory environment, which is setting prices on externalities, but ultimately those decisions have to be made by farmers. So I would be the last person to say you should put it all into Manuka and launch into Manuka honey. I mean, that might be a really good option for your land. But
just to add a little bit more context, around about, on my estimation, somewhere about 90 to 95% of the businesses in Wanganui depend on agriculture, either as a primary source of income or as a contributor to the economy. When you actually look in the phone book and decide how many companies don't depend on agriculture, it's probably less than the fingers on your hand. Now, that means that whatever you do to farming in Wanganui has a huge effect on the town, because effectively, if we spend a dollar as a farmer in town, it goes around this community five times.
Mm.
If I don't spend a dollar, that's $5 that isn't in the community. So what the Green Party decides to do for agriculture has a real effect for Wanganui and a flow-on effect to the national.
No, no, I say that would be the same for any government policy that affects the regions, for good or bad. I mean, Wanganui is not alone, but I mean, every regional town in New Zealand is pretty much in that same place.
My understanding is that the Green Party has a memorandum of understanding or something with the Labour Party. If the Green Party and the Labour Party form the next government, what hope do the Green Party have of the Labour Party taking any notice of them?
That's a really good question. I guess I'd say that if you want them to take more notice, Party voting Green is the best way to make sure that we have a market presence. No, but the MOU is basically an agreement to work together to change the government. Now, there will be a post-election negotiation process that literally depends on the numbers. So the larger, the more strength the Green Party has, the more power in those negotiations we would have. So, you know, no political party can make a promise that their policies will be in government, because some of them will always get, they'll be victims of the process. So,
leading on from that, does the Green Party have a policy about the selling off of great tracts of our New Zealand country to overseas buyers?
Selling off of the great tracts?
Yeah.
Oh, tracts, right.
Yes,
so we had a policy at the last election that anything over, I think it was, I forget what size it was. There was a size of land that we deemed that was basically too large to sell, without a proper process.
You still have that policy?
It hasn't changed from last election, as far as I'm aware.
Thank you.
Getting back to that synthetic milk or not, and the quantity of water required to manufacture milk as opposed to growing milk or beef or anything else. How is that amount of water calculated? Because there seem to be some significant figures bandied around of the quantity of water required to produce 1 kilo of meat or 1 kilogram of milk or whatever.
Mm.
Is that calculation including rainfall? And if it is, why do we get penalised for utilising something that's naturally falling out of the sky?
Short answer, I don't know the figures well enough to give you a solid answer. But it's a good point. I think most of those calculations normally additional water, not what's already in the environment. But I mean, even if we're out by a large factor, the numbers I've seen around synthetic protein are, you know, orders of magnitude less than growing beef and growing milk outside. So you've got a lot of wiggle room to be quite wrong and still be a lot less.
I think I'm up to my last one.
Rachel.
I just want to say how glad I am that farmers turned out tonight to join me. So thank you for being here. I think it's really important that we listen to each other. I haven't agreed with a lot of what I've heard tonight from the farmers who have spoken. But I think it's really important we come together in the same room and hear each other out. Because I am very much struck by the increasing bitterness that I'm seeing in public discussion around farming and the impacts of farming. And I'm also really aware of the challenges for farmers, and particularly for people running family scale businesses in more traditional waterways. There's a lot of common ground, right from, you know, viewpoints right across the political spectrum. And it's always going to come back to the fact that we all like to eat. You know, we have that in common. We all have to work, it's really good to look for that common ground and debate the issues.
Thank you, that's a great comment, probably the perfect place to
land. It was, thank you. That was a wonderful comment to finish on, and I'd like to really echo that. I knew we'd have Green Party members here tonight, and I was hoping that we'd have members from the rural community here, and I'm really pleased we have had the mix and been able to be together in this way, because like Rachel said, we do all need to eat. So I just want to wrap up by saying thank you so much, John, for driving over from the Wairarapa in his Nissan Leaf, I would like to say, stopped and plugged in Palmy before he got here, plug in overnight, get back. He's stopping in Fielding tomorrow to talk to people there, and maybe also in Palmy. So if you've got friends or family that you want to say pop along, please have a word to me or John, and we'll pass on the details of where they can catch up with him tomorrow. I really hope this is the start of us being able to have more of those conversations, and certainly as a regional councillor, they're the conversations I want to keep continuing, which is how do we integrate green thinking that is actually progressive and not scary into how we manage the land for really good, truly sustainable outcomes, not just for the environment, but for our communities and our people as well. So thank you very much, John. Please stay for a cup of tea.
I was feeling a bit apprehensive thinking